The wound heals, but it never does. That's cause you at war with love. You at war with love.
These battle scars don't look like they're fading.
It did seem to me that by 1983, things had kind of come to a head.
There's no question, that's when the calls started coming.
If you're gonna be a dirty program, you better be good at it. You better understand that the group handling the dirtiness has to be small, and it has to be committed, and it doesn't go out and chirp at bars.
It was a sick atmosphere surrounding SMU football.
February or so of 1983, when I got handed the SMU file, I think there were 13 reports from institutions outside and inside the Southwest Conference.
They were getting phone calls from the other schools saying, you gotta come down here and investigate these people.
SMU was the new fastest gun in the West, but it wasn't a traditional power.
Then when SMU expanded its national recruiting and started going to Michigan, started going to Pennsylvania, those schools started calling, saying, you know, SMU is recruiting this guy.
They had no real rapport with the NCAA. They were completely unprotected and they were asking for it.
Dickerson from Sealy, Texas, puts SMU on the board.
When you stepped on the field against SMU, you had your hands full during the early 80s.
We wanted to play football with the best in the country, and we wanted to beat the best in the country. They just really were a gifted college football team.
That was the era of the Pony Express.
Eric Dickerson and Craig James, the Pony Express.
You're talking about two of the best ever.
We could beat anybody we walked on the field with.
We weren't even worried about who we played because we knew we could beat them.
These guys can play with anybody.
They were unstoppable.
There was no question about it.
This was the dynasty program in college football.
We're competing with ourselves. We want to see how good we can get.
We had that swagger about us.
Had the talent, the speed. We'd hit you.
By Thursday, everyone knew we were going to win on Saturday.
They were simply an enormous national power.
That's going to attract attention.
Coming out of high school, when I went to SMU, everybody was saying, you're crazy. You know, why you go to SMU? You'll never win.
How did they get all those guys?
They must be doing something wrong.
29 violations.
We run basically an honest program. There was a whole lot of cheating going on.
Top Punch champions.
We'll celebrate this moment.
SMU was the best team that money could buy.
Oh, absolutely. Best team money could buy.
The best team money can buy.
Can't describe it. It's something I've wanted to do all my life.
Can hardly describe.
Can't believe it. I don't know what to say.
Cheating in the recruitment of high school football stars.
They can do stuff they will never get caught in.
You got to decide if the player wants to be legally recruited.
$50,000 in a briefcase.
If they did pay me, they paid for a project they wanted.
Our university couldn't be prouder of what you did this season.
There remains a joke that Eric Dickerson took a pay cut when he came to the NFL.
I mean, I seriously, I think I just heard it last week.
Thousands of dollars in cash gifts.
Yeah! Texas Governor Bill Clements.
We made the wrong decision.
Get caught and do it again.
Everybody deserves a day in court. We're getting ours.
Get caught and do it again.
No live telecasts of SMU game.
Get caught and do it again.
Here come the Mustangs. Oh, look out.
Once they were a storied football power, but today their story is largely forgotten.
The Athletic Association has severely penalized the
Methodist University.
Number one, as far as I'm concerned.
Football program for 7 months.
Stiffest ever imposed.
Harshest penalties ever imposed.
This is that story about a school, about a city.
The school was hit with a death penalty.
Death penalty.
SMU has received the toughest penalty ever given a major college football program.
The first in.
Had told me, we're going to recruit a kid out of Sealy. And he said, I'm not going to tell you who he is. I want to take you to practice. I want you to point him out for me. We drove up, and I got out. We walked up to the fence, and I stood there for a few minutes, and I said, that's him. I said, yep, that's him. I said, who is he? He said, that's Eric Dickerson. Gives to Dickerson. It's a touchdown.
He's in. One more, he's gone.
97 yards.
I was the number one recruited player in the whole nation coming out of high school. You know, just Dan Marino, Elway, all of us on the blue chip list.
Eric Dickerson was the most impressive high school player any of us had ever seen. And when you come from the state of Texas, that's a very large statement.
It must be pretty good. I guess they wouldn't be coming to see him and calling every day and night.
That was one guy that I didn't think we were going to get.
He could have gone anywhere in the country.
As a senior at Sealy High School in 1978, Eric Dickerson was the most sought-after player in the state.
Every college football factory wanted him.
Eric really wanted to go to Oklahoma.
He's an outstanding prospect. A lot of other coaches think so, too. There's quite a few here tonight.
He had a great time at Southern Cal. Texas was in the hunt, but he just didn't like the recruiter that was recruiting him at Texas.
When it comes to recruiting, coaches can be real nasty with it.
University of Texas came to my house. The recruiter tells me, if you consider going out of state of Texas, he said, when you come out of college, we can make sure you don't get a job in the state of Texas. I thought he was joking. And he said, I'm serious. I told him, F you, man. I said, I'll never go to Texas. I hated Texas from that point on.
Everyone in Sealy wanted to go to A&M.
Sealy was an A&M town, very A&M. So I was getting it from all angles to go to A&M. The recruiters would show up my house day and night.
One night it was like 2 o'clock in the morning. Coach comes in my room, you know, asks me, what am I thinking about at 2 o'clock in the morning?
I'm like, huh? I mean, I couldn't believe it.
And I told him, I'm thinking about going to sleep.
A&M did offer a lot, a lot. They showed my mother $50,000 in a briefcase.
I saw money from different schools, savings bonds, women, 2 Cadillacs. You know what we needed? 2 Cadillacs. Anything they thought that really caught your attention?
Cattle, livestock?
Yeah, livestock.
About a week and a half before signing day, Ron came, got me out of a meeting and said, take a look at this. And it was a Houston paper that had a huge headline, Eric Dickerson going to A&M.
I get a call from my sports editor. Eric Dickerson has shown up at school today in a gold Trans Am. It was this gleaming gold prize. It was so in your face.
We call it the Trans A&M.
I remember waking up, opening the Sunday paper, and there was a picture of Eric with the Trans Am. When that happened, I said, oh, God, it's over. We lost.
I had a Trans Am, a gold Trans Am, and my grandmother bought it, and that's the story.
Look like they're ever gone away. They ain't never gonna change these better.
Lord, never let a wound ruin me, but I feel like ruin's wooing me. Arrow holes that never close from Cupid on a shooting spree. Feeling stupid cause I know it ain't no you and me. But when you're trying to beat the odds up and trying to keep your nods up, and you know that you should know and let it go, but the fear of the unknown hone another lover's phone sends you back into the zone. With no Tom Hanks to bring you home, a lover not a fighter on the front line with a poem. Trying to write yourself a rifle, maybe sharpen up a song to fight the tanks and drones of you being alone.
I wish I never would, I wish I never touched. I wish that I could stop loving you so much. Cause I'm the only one that's trying to keep us together.
Yeah.
When all of the signs say that I should forget her.
Uh-huh.
I wish you were the best I ever had.
Yeah.
I wish that the good outweighed the bad. Cause
yeah.
It'll never be over.
It'll never be over.